Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom now and forever.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O merciful Creator, your hand is open wide to satisfy the needs of every living creature. Make us always thankful for your loving providence, and grant that we, remembering the account that we must one day give, may be faithful stewards of your good gift. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman who you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." To the woman he said, "I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children, yet your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you." And to the man he said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree about which I commanded you, you shall not eat. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken. You are dust, and to dust you shall return." The man named his wife Eve, because she was the mother of all who live. And the Lord God made garments of the skins for the man and for his wife, and clothed them. Then the Lord God said, "See, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil. And now he might reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life, and eat and live forever." Therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. He drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden he placed the cherubim and a sword, flaming and turning, to guard the way to the tree of life. The word of the Lord.
If I climb up to heaven, you are there. If I make the grave my bed, you are there also. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand hold me fast. If I say, "Surely the darkness will cover me, and the light around me turn to night," darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light to you are both alike. For you yourself created my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Alleluia. 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 Father, we praise you as Lord. All of the earth gives you worship. For your majesty fills the heavens, fills the earth. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority do you do these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another. "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say, 'Of human origin,' we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not.' But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, 'I go, sir,' but he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of heaven ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The very beginning of the Bible tells us an origin story, the creation of the whole universe. And it's a wonderful poem, a liturgical poem. It's a poem of how out of nothing, God made something. And that nothingness that we hear about in the Bible is the Hebrew words tohu wabohu. And what that means is a sort of original chaos of the universe, an emptiness, a silence. And out of that void, God creates the whole biosphere. All things in mutual relationship with one another, a web of life and interdependence and and mutual relationship. And that relationship the Bible calls shalom. The Bible's vision is that God is the source of all life, and that human beings are one constituent part of that great web. And we have a vocation to serve the earth and to shepherd the earth and to bring it to its potential as God's divine image bearers, reflecting the creative action of God, co-creators, co-sustainers with the divine. Isaiah 11 gives us a wonderful image of that peaceable kingdom, that kingdom of shalom. You may remember the famous words, the wolf shall lie with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the young lion and the fatling together. And a little child will lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, and their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like an ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on an adder's den. And they will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. What a wonderful image of the shalom of God, the dream of God for all creation. In his wonderful encyclical Laudato Si, Pope Francis describes it this way: we understand better the importance and meaning of each creature if we contemplate it within the entirety of God's plan. The spectacle of their countless diversities and inequalities tells us that no creature is self-sufficient. Creatures exist only in dependence on each other, to complete each other, in the service of each other. But our ancient ancestors knew that that vision of the peaceable kingdom was not the one that they saw on the ground in the world around us. We human beings have walked a different path than the way of shalom, that is God's great hope for the whole creation. And today we hear from the story in Genesis 3, the mythic story that describes to us that alienation from God's shalom. Earlier in the story than we have today, the woman listens not to God, but to the voice of the serpent, the voice of selfishness, of pride, and of greed. The human voice that says, we know better, and we want it all for ourselves, acquisitiveness. The vision that we have this morning is a vision of the undoing of creation. There are two ways set forth in that story, the one way toward the fruitful garden and the other way toward the wasteland, because that word tohu vabohu in Hebrew also means the place of desolate waste. And so imagine in your mind two paths, one that leads to the fertile garden and one that leads to the wasteland. And we hear the voice of God in this morning's first reading. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life, thorns and thistles that shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field, and by the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for you are dust. And to dust you shall return. The image of another path, a vision of what awaits all those who choose the path of selfishness and pride and greed. We see a similar idea in the fourth chapter of the book of Jeremiah, where the prophet, who is a seer, looks to the future if we continue down the path that humans have gone down. And he says, I looked on the earth, and lo, it was waste and void, and to the heavens, and they had no light. I looked on the mountains, and lo, they were quaking, and the hills moved to and fro. I looked, and lo, there was no one at all. And all the birds of the air had fled, and I looked, and lo, the fruitful land was a desert, and all its cities were laid ruin before the Lord, before his fierce anger. In our day, we can see the vision that Jeremiah had about continuing down the path of greed and selfishness and destruction and seeing ourselves as the center of our universe. We can look all around us at the reality of climate change, of increasing temperatures throughout the globe, desertification of once fertile places, the destruction of species, farming practices that destroy the earth and wreak havoc on farmers, habitat destruction and human encroachment in previously wild environments. We could go on and on about the list that is causing this beautiful garden to become a wasteland. We see it lived out in part in the California wildfires, although we've always had wildfires, none to the extent that we have now. And in part because we have tried to manage forests, and in part because of climate change. We can look even at the COVID pandemic, in part the result of encroaching on wild environments where humans never had gone before. The gradual warming of the earth, hurricanes and storms in numbers and intensity not seen before. Jeremiah 4 speaks loudly that the lament of the earth cries out to God. But it is a lament based in hope, because we know that there can be a better way. We believe in the God who is the creator. We believe that that God came among us in the flesh of Jesus, and he died on the cross and was buried in the ground as a seed and sprung back to life and started in a little garden outside of Jerusalem, a whole new possibility for the earth. The vision of the Bible calls us to change our minds and our hearts, to turn around, to start towards the path of God's shalom. One of the great fathers of the early church, Bishop Basil the Great, prayed this: O God, he said, enlarge within us the sense of fellowship with all living things, our little brothers, the animals, to whom thou hast given this earth as their home in common with us. We remember with shame that in the past we have exercised the high dominion of man with ruthless cruelty, so that the voice of this earth, which should have gone up to thee in song, has been a groan of travail. May we realize that they live not for us alone, but for themselves and for thee, and that they love the sweetness of life even as we, and serve thee in their place better than we in ours. But the hope of the new creation and changing our hearts and minds does not allow us to be paralyzed. We need to cooperate with God on the path of life and not death, to have before us the vision of shalom and do concrete actions that will help to support that. We need to cooperate with other people of goodwill and coalition building to restore our planet. And we also need to see that the struggle of repairing the earth is aligned with the struggle for justice among human beings, because the same forces of selfishness and pride and greed are at the root of our social injustice as well. The struggle is one. They are not in competition. The struggle is one. And so we are people of hope, even in the midst of all the destruction we see around us, hope that there can be a way forward if we will look to the vision of God's shalom and act as one to repair the earth, to seek justice, and peace. There is a prayer that we all know, I think. It's attributed to St. Francis of Assisi, who we often think of in this creation season. Lord, make us instruments of your peace, of your shalom. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is discord, union. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. Grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. That is the vision of God's shalom. May it be so. Amen.
We say together in faith,
Holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
We believe in God the Father, who created all things.
For by his will they were created and have their being.
We believe in God the Son, who was slain.
For with his blood he purchased us for God, from every tribe and language, from every people and nation.
We believe in God, the Holy Spirit.
The Spirit and the Bride say, Come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants celebrating birthdays and anniversaries this month, as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God said, Let there be lights in the sky to separate the day and the night. We thank you for the warmth of the sun, the light of the moon, the glory of the stars. We praise you for the formations of clouds and the radiance of dawn and sunset. Save us from wasting or abusing the energy on which all life depends. Open our eyes to behold your beauty, and our lips to praise your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, Let the waters bring forth living creatures, and let birds fly across the sky. We thank you for the teeming life of the seas and the flight of birds. Help us to protect the environment so that all life may flourish. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind. We rejoice in the variety of animal life. Grant us grace to treat all animals with respect and care, to protect endangered species, to preserve the variety of habitats, and to honor the delicate balance of nature. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God said, Let us create human beings in our own image. We pray for the human family. We exalt in its diversity and giftedness. We repent of its sins, divisions, and violence. By the power of the Spirit, restore your image within us. Through Christ, who came to remake us by his death and resurrection, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Season of wildfires in the American West, we pray to God for the blessing of rain. O God, in whom we live, move, and have our being, grant us sufficient rain, so that being supplied with what sustains us in this present life, we may seek more confidently what sustains us for eternity. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Morning. And we welcome you digitally today to St. John's Cathedral for our service this morning that celebrates the season of creation. We have a few announcements this morning. One is that if you haven't registered to vote, we encourage you to do so. October 17th is the last day that you will be able to register to vote. And the single most important act that each of us can do as individuals in our society today, the single most productive act of social engagement, is to cast a ballot. So if you have not registered to vote, we invite you to do so by October the 17th. And on November 3rd, or before, make sure that your ballot somehow gets in and is counted either by mail or in person. Our flowers today were given by Martha and Arnie Ree in honor of Judy Elizabeth Fonschel, their new grandniece, recently born in Paderborn, Germany. We're continuing our State of the City forums in preparation for the election, and October the 6th we'll have a representative from Black Lives Matter to be our guest at the next State of the City forum on Tuesday, October the 6th, and that's at 7 p.m. Next week, we conclude our creation season reading of the book of an agrarian reading of the Bible, Scripture, Culture, and Agriculture by Dr. Ellen Davis. Dr. Davis will be with us in our forum at 9:30 next Sunday. That will be available live on Facebook. It will be a wonderful time, I'm quite sure. That book has been a great blessing to those of us who have been reading it throughout this creation season, and we're very glad to be able to welcome a conversation with Dr. Davis. Next Sunday, we also celebrate the Feast of St. Michael and All Angels, and we will have a festival Eucharist in celebration of that feast. And also at 8 a.m. next Sunday, we will return to in-person worship at 8 a.m. in our garden with our first in-person worship mass. That will be at 8 a.m. next Sunday morning. You must have a reservation, however, to attend. We have limited seating, and we want to make sure that we can accommodate the folks who wish to come. So please make a reservation on our website or by emailing the church office with that information about who is coming also from your household. We have the opportunity now to give back to God out of the abundance that we have been given, because we all share with one another in the gift of life. And so we offer back to God the abundance of our lives at this time. Appearing on your screen right now are the various ways that you can give, and we invite you, please, to be generous. If you are a member of this congregation, we invite your generosity here at St. John's. If you are a member of another congregation, we invite you first to give out of your abundance to your home congregation. We pray that you would be blessed in your giving.
Spirit of the Lord fills the whole earth. Alleluia.
Thank you. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord God of all life, we rejoice in the world which you have made and in the creatures with which you have filled it, to share our journey, to be our companions on the way. For whales and dolphins and all who travel the deep, for eagles and sparrows and all that fly, for cats and dogs, turtles and cattle, crickets and all that fill forests and fields. United with all your creatures, we offer you thanksgiving for your act of love in creation, and we joyfully accept our responsibility to care for the creation that so powerfully reflects your majesty. In the earth's beginning, as a sign of our relationship with you, you entrusted humanity with the stewardship of your creation. But blinded by indifference and selfish pursuits, we turned away from you, squandered your gifts, and wandered into the way of sin and death. Then you, in your unending mercy, sent us Jesus Christ, your only and eternal child, to share our life, embracing even death itself. By his victory over death, he reconciles us to you, the lover and creator of all, and creates a new heaven and a new earth, renewing all life into your perfect image. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, while he was at supper with his friends, Jesus took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine and gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Maker of all, we now celebrate your renewal of creation, the transformation and redemption of the world, and we show forth that sacrifice which has made all things new by means of this bread and this cup. Bless and sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your holy and life-giving Spirit, that this communion may gather all flesh into one community in your child Jesus' name for all time and all eternity. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Those who cannot now receive Holy Communion, we pray. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things and desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord of all, as with joy we have offered thanksgiving for your love in creation, move our hearts to be generous and wise stewards of the good things you have given us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Go forth into the world, honoring and loving all creation.
Thanks be to God.
I'm Christopher Gravis, canon for music and cathedral arts here at St. John's. When we consider the broken world in which we live, politically, economically, and racially, to some, looking at names and dates from 500 or 100 or even 50 years ago, it might not be apparent how the music of our tradition speaks to the heart of who we are and who we are called to be. Bishop Taylor noted 2 weeks ago that Christianity was born in the midst of a chaotic and unjust world. And we can sometimes hear the struggle of our own experiences, dissonances, and sweet moments in music that moves us, challenges us, and ennobles us to recognize the divine in ourselves and in one another. Thomas Tallis, William Byrd, and John Marbeck composed music in the midst of frightening political strife between Protestant and Catholic factions within the English Church. They wrote music that we still sing today and still moves people to tears. Amazing Grace isn't just a beloved hymn. It's the contrite words of a converted slaver, changed to gospel in his own road to Damascus experience. When we sing those words, we acknowledge our own complicity in entrenched, institutionalized sin and the redemption that we still receive in spite of ourselves. And when we begin the last verse of Lift Every Voice and Sing with weary heaviness, we toil in solidarity with our brothers and sisters everywhere who have walked a life under oppression. I'm an Episcopalian in large part because ours is a faith that recognizes that music is so much more than songs that just make us feel good. Music is the mystery through which our hearts can be rendered to love one another. And it's why I'm so proud to be a part of St. John's Cathedral.
I'm Zach Neufeld, and I'm the organist here at the Cathedral. Like Chris, I celebrate the appreciation that we Episcopalians place on art, music, and our artistic freedom to choose music that we want to play. The music in the Anglican tradition is what drew me to the Episcopal Church in the first place. Chris and I both went to University of Redlands, where we studied with Dr. Jeffrey Ricard, who introduced us to all the beautiful music that we play and still play here at St. John's. And I was enamored with the mellifluous sounds of the organ and the choir. And it was that that drew me to this music before I fully appreciated its power and, like Chris said, its power to be something more than just something that makes us feel good. I love the fact that we use music from a long tradition in our church, but in a place like St. John's, we can reframe it in the lens of social justice. I also appreciate the fact that we live in a time when we can shine music on people who have often been marginalized, and we can celebrate music by people of color and the LGBTQ+ community. And we have just begun that journey of discovering all of the music from those communities that we haven't appreciated and celebrated thus far. My hope is that in celebrating that music and continuing to celebrate the music of our tradition that we already have, that we can create new traditions that include those marginalized people in the name of social justice.